What are the common objects of our love? Those things St. Augustine said bind a people into a nation. One thing, as we explore in the American Holidays series of JES Scholar in Residence, Dr. Andrew Roth, is what people celebrate. Yes, that song. What are we celebrating? And in this installment, what we are celebrating, we're taking a look at how Americans celebrate two fall holidays. Hello and welcome to the Jefferson Educational Society's digital programming. I'm Ben Spagan. I'm the vice president at the JES. Halloween. What are its roots? What is Allhallowtide? How does it connect to the ancient Celtic celebration of Samhain? And why trick-or-treat? Thanksgiving. What really happened in 1619 Virginia and 1621 at Plymouth Colony? Who was Sara Josepha Hale, the 19th century Martha Stewart, and Lydia Maria Child, who wrote To Grandfather's House We Go? And how did President Franklin Roosevelt set Thanksgiving's date? Answers to those questions is what we'll seek here with Dr. Roth as he continues his extension of the American Tapestry Project, exploring the common objects of our love and how Americans tell their stories through the people, places, and things they celebrate. Now, you might recognize Dr. Roth from his book notes series published by the JES or his American Tapestry Project. That's both a radio program featured locally in area on WQLN Public Media and nationally on the NPR One app, and is a JES digital programming series. Now, in that programming series, you might recall that I've introduced him in the past. I've noted his accomplished career in academia, from lecturing to leading, as he's taught various courses before going on to serve in various administrations in Erie and lead Notre Dame College in Cleveland as its president before retiring and being named president emeritus. Breaking free from that tightening grip of retirement, Dr. Roth heeded the call to serve as the interim president of St. Bonaventure University. Now, seeing his vulnerability when it comes to maintaining a relationship with the retirement, we at the JES wrangled him in, where he's been serving as a scholar in residence, offering numerous lectures, producing plenty of publications, and facilitating the Ramey Fellow Program. Now, for a fuller and much deserved bio, head over to our website, jeserie.org. Folks, since this program is first airing live on the JES Facebook page, we'll work our way through as many questions from you, the viewers, as we can as we host this event. If you have a question, just leave it in the comment section below. If you're listening to or watching a later broadcast of this streaming on demand, please still send us your questions, your comments to keep this conversation going. And of course, for more information about upcoming JES programs and publications, visit jeserie.org and be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. It is my pleasure to welcome back to the JES digital stage, Dr. Andrew Roth. Dr. Roth, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you, Ben. It's good to be back with you again as we continue our exploration of American holidays. And for our returning viewers and the number of people who have seen these either live streamed with us or have seen it later on Facebook or on our website continues to grow. So I'm going to go over rather quickly the background for the series. If there's a first-time viewer, you can get a more complete explanation of the underlying philosophy of the series by looking at one of the earliest episodes. But in any event, one question that we do usually talk about is, how many holidays do Americans celebrate? It was working a minute ago. And the answer to that question is, they celebrate 256. I'm going to try to keep this cursor down in the right-hand corner instead of nervously bouncing all over the screen. And of those 256 holidays, by the way, that's not from any particularly august source. It's from timeanddate.com, but it's a reliable source, and they list 256 holidays that Americans in some manner, shape, or form acknowledge, observe, celebrate. There's probably actually more. But today we're going to take a close look at two, as Ben said. We're going to look at Halloween. Where did that come from? And we're going to look at Thanksgiving Day. Thanksgiving Day is interesting because we're going to touch on the theme of this whole series. The way Americans celebrate Thanksgiving is in many ways not because of what happened in the 17th century, but what happened in the early 19th century. And Sara Josepha Hale, who Ben was talking of, who mentioned briefly, I call her the Martha Stewart of the 19th century, and I mean that as a compliment to her and to Martha Stewart. But in some ways, Hale is actually an even more important cultural figure. She and many other early 19th century people, much like this American Tapestry Project, this American Holidays Project, they were trying to figure out how do you bond together a group of diverse people in those days, they're thinking about original states plus the states that had been added, came from all kinds of different backgrounds. And how did you get them to think about themselves as Americans? And one of the solutions they landed on, interestingly enough, was holidays. And we're going to see that with Thanksgiving Day, and we're going to see it even more next month when we take a look at Christmas. In any event, Thanksgiving and Halloween are two major holidays. Halloween, well, Christmas and Thanksgiving, which season we are now in, I think we can all say that begins with November 1st, the day after Halloween ends, All Saints Day, as you're going to discover in a minute. Well, Christmas and Thanksgiving combined spending is almost $1,000 per capita. Every man, woman, and child in the United States, in theory, spends $1,000 on Christmas and Thanksgiving. And quite frankly, the bulk of that, probably 700 to 800 of those dollars, are spent on Christmas. Thanksgiving is actually probably a more modest 100, which would put it down, interestingly enough, somewhere around Halloween, which we see in this National Retail Federation listing the holidays in the order, the descending order of which Americans spend money on them. Thanksgiving is up there at number one with Christmas and Thanksgiving, the holiday season. But Halloween is an interesting one. They're coming in at number six, and interestingly enough, as we'll hear in a moment, growing. Well, what is all of this interest in holidays about? As Ben said, my American Tapestry Project on WQLN and also at the Jefferson, you can see the links. Go to WQLN's website and you'll find all of the programs, or go to the Jefferson's website and you'll find the American Tapestry Project and you'll find American Holidays. But what I'm trying to do there, and I want to go over this rather quickly so as not to be too repetitive for people who have watched earlier episodes. I'm interested in the American story. I think part of what has happened that has fractured our politics, has fractured our culture in some ways, is that Americans no longer agree on what the American story is. The American Holiday series grows out of that because it's one of the places we see in a very real way what are the things that Americans value. And what Americans value, as we've said before, I think come in two big buckets. The profound America's civil religion, which is the notion that America is not an ethnicity of blood and soil. It's an ethnicity based on an idea. And that idea's most literal expressions, the second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, we hold these truths. But there are other pieces to that idea. The piece about democratic government with a small d, which we are now all somewhat worried about. It's also some basic commitment to free market capitalism. That commitment ranges, as we all know, in American culture from those who are intense devotees of it to those who think it is in need of reform, and also a commitment to just the general civic welfare and civic engagement. But you also find it in what I call the banal in pop culture. So much of the things that holds a culture together are those things that people enjoy in the everyday world. So the common objects of our love, and they find their expression in holidays. And so the whole premise of this series is, what does what we celebrate, why we celebrate, and how we celebrate it tell us about the American story and who we are as Americans, and how can understanding it perhaps help us transcend the culture wars by recognizing the common objects of our love. And like I ever so briefly said, we're going to hear a little bit about it with Thanksgiving today. We'll hear a great deal about it next month when we look at Christmas. Very self-consciously, any number of people, Sara Josepha Hale was a major figure in this, thought that one way to create a common culture out of diverse people, and by diversity, they would have meant something different than we mean, but nonetheless, maybe use a different word since diversity in our time has a certain kind of meaning. How do you blend a polyglot people who come from all different kinds of places and at least superficially would appear not to share a lot in common? How do you bond them together into a culture? And one of the things they landed on was holidays. And we're now nearing the end of this series, but for those of you who are first-time viewers, we've worked our way through Candlemas, Valentine's, and Presidents back in February, ethnic holidays, commercial holidays, the celebrating freedom, the 4th of July. Last month, we looked at sporting holidays, and if you'll recall that Retail Federation sign, the Super Bowl is now the number 8 or was it number 7? I should know this by heart after all of this, ranked holiday in terms of consumer spending. Today, we're going to look at Halloween and Thanksgiving, and then next month, we're going to take, and I would emphasize the word brief, a brief look at the history of Christmas. So today, Halloween and Thanksgiving. Halloween and Thanksgiving are harvest festivals. Harvest festivals are ancient. They go back pre-literate human society, deep into ancient culture, and every culture in the world has a harvest festival. In Jewish culture, you have the festival of Sukkot. Ancient Egyptians had the festival of Min. All of these are about bringing in the harvest. In Persian culture, you have the Meherin festival. And in China, you have the Harvest Moon festival, interestingly enough. I don't think that's what Neil Diamond was thinking about, but the Chinese have Neil Young was thinking about. But the Celts, and we're going to discover the Scots, the English, and the Irish, but the Celts, they had a big influence on us. They had the celebration of Lunasa, which was the god represented there, and Lammas, which was a harvest festival typically occurring, and it is still celebrated to this day. It is still celebrated in Wales, Ireland, and in Scotland, and in Cornwall and the west of England. And it's celebrated on August 1st because it's the beginning of the harvest season. And then, of course, you have the Indonesian rice harvest festival. So harvest festivals are ancient, and they are probably amongst one of the most human things that humans do. And we're going to talk about that when we look at the roots of Halloween. Why harvest festivals? Well, in pre-modern agricultural societies, the harvest, particularly in northern climes, and I guess the thing, the opposite would be true in far southern climes, but in the southern hemisphere, the southernmost reaches were not as occupied or as populated as they are in the northern hemisphere. The harvest was critical. If it was a good harvest, it was a time for celebration. If it was a bad harvest, it was a time for lamentation, because how are you going to get through the winter? How are you going to have enough food? Winter was looked upon as the dark season. It was looked upon as the dying season. And harvest festivals are all about that tension at the end of the growing season. Is there enough food? And placating the gods, et cetera, et cetera. So today we're going to look at two harvest festivals that have ancient roots. The most ancient of the two, by the way, is Halloween, even more ancient than Thanksgiving. But two harvest festivals that Americans celebrate widely, obviously, perhaps without always knowing exactly what it is they're celebrating. And the first one we'll look at will be Halloween, which has its roots in an ancient Celtic festival. Today, it's about candy and children by and large, but not always. And
I've got plenty to be thankful for.
And as Bing Crosby sings, we celebrate Thanksgiving Day to give thanks. So let's take a look at these two harvest festivals that Americans celebrate. The first one we'll look at will be Halloween. And how is Halloween celebrated in Erie, Pennsylvania? And I know there are probably people watching these eventually on Facebook or on YouTube from around, not from Erie, but this is the Jefferson's and Erie Institution. And I think probably the bulk of our viewers are Erieites, past or present. In Erie, it's children trick-or-treating. Where did that come from? We're gonna look at that. You have Boo at the Lagoon. Waldemere always has some kind of party, or they used to. We have haunted houses. Where did haunted houses come from? Why did that become a popular thing? We have a calendar of all kinds of events. We have jack-o'-lanterns. The art museum sponsors something. One of the interesting things is, and I'm going to use a number of his paintings over the thing, is, well, most people think of Norman Rockwell as the person who created the Saturday Evening Post covers. Actually, a great number of them were written, painted, or created by an Erie artist, Eugene Ivard, and the Hagen Historical Center has a collection of Eugene Ivards, and that there is a Eugene Ivard Saturday Evening Post cover. We have around the county, there's any number, this happens to be Port Farms in Waterford, there are any number of pumpkin patches and places that have harvest festivals and celebrations. And of course, the Erie Zoo has Zubu. So Halloween's a big deal in Erie. But where did it come from? And in particular, where did pumpkins and ghosts and goblins and skeletons and all of that, where did that come from? Well, a great deal of what we, of the actual specific activities that people engage in on Halloween come from a Celtic poem, just as we discovered with Auld Lang Syne, Robert Burns' poem we looked at, I wrote a book note about it. I don't think we actually looked at it in the American Holiday series. And in 1785, Burns wrote a poem, Halloween. Most people do not think it is one of his better poems if we're going to look at its literary merits, but anthropologists look at it and folklorists look at it as an incredible source, almost a primary documentary source of how Halloween specific traditions began. And right now, let's listen to Cameron Goodall reciting at least the first two stanzas of Burns' Halloween. Goodall recorded this at the Globe Pub in Dumfries, Scotland on October 30th, the night before, on Halloween's Eve in 2014.
Upon that night, when fairies, licht when castles, downings dance, or o'er the leas in splendid blaze, on sprightly coursers, prance, or for Colleen the route is ta'en, aneath the moon's pale beams, there, up the cove, to stray and rove among the rocks and streams, to sport that nicht amang the bony winding banks, where Doon runs wimpling clear, where Bruce yance ruled the martial ranks and shook the Carrick spear, some merry, friendly country folks together did convene to burn their nuts and poor stokes and hoard the Halloween foo blithe that night.
Okay, that was Cameron Goodall in genuine Scots dialect reciting the first two stanzas of Burns' poem. It's a 252-line long poem. For those of you who might be find the dialect a little challenging, I'll try to work up a simple translation, and all it says is really, upon that night when fairies light on castles and downings dance, what it means is people believed in fairies, they believed in spirits, and the light of the spirits lit up the meadows, lit up the moor, or over the leas in splendid blaze on sprightly coursers prance or their riding horses. Or for Colian, the route is taken. Colian is the cove he's talking about. Beneath, obviously, the moon's pale beams, the moonlight. There, up the cove, to stray and rove among the rocks and streams, to play, to party that night, the folk went. And they were going along the bonny, that is the pretty, the beautiful, winding banks of the River Doon, where the River Doon runs, running clear, where Robert Bruce, Braveheart, once ruled the martial ranks and shook his Carrick spear fighting the English. Well, what's happening is some merry, friendly country folks are gathering there to burn their nuts and pour their stocks, whiskey, and hold their Halloween full blithe, full of fun that night. And then Burns continues to explain in detail or illustrate what exactly it is the folk were going to do celebrating that night. So that's where much of what people, ironically enough, in the English-speaking world, how they celebrate Halloween, I say ironically because Burns intentionally wrote it in Scots dialect as a rebuke of English culture, of an attempt to restrain it and preserve Scots culture. Okay, that's where many of the folk customs come from. What does the word Halloween mean? Well, Halloween is actually Scottish. My colleague David Frew said, I won't say what David said. David, who is Scots, said if something is a little off center, it probably came from Scotland. But in any event, I don't know if he meant to be quoted on that. In any event, Halloween is a Scottish shortening of Allhallowe'en. Well, what's that? That's the eve of All Saints' Day. Hallow, H-A-L-L-O-W, means someone who is holy or virtuous, or someone who has been sainted or acknowledged as such. So Allhallow-even is the evening before All Hallows Day, the eve of All Saints Day, All Hallows Day. It's the last night of October. It's also the last night of the year in the old Celtic calendar, where it was Old Year's Night, a night for witches. And that becomes important for how we celebrate Halloween in a minute. In Scots, the word eve for evening, eve is even, and this is contracted to een, E apostrophe E-N, or een. Over time, All Hallows Even evolved into Halloween, and eventually the apostrophe drops away. So that's where the word comes from. Okay, I like words, so I'm not going to belabor the point, but that's where the word comes from. It's actually a Scots word. So how did Burns's good merry country folks celebrate Halloween? Well, one of the things they did is they built bonfires. And one of the characteristics in many cultures of the world, particularly northern cultures, when celebrating the harvest is the burning of bonfires. And in Celtic, northern European, not all northern European cultures Celtic, but in Celtic culture and many other northern European cultures, bonfires are a powerful symbol of life. Why are they a powerful symbol of affirming life? Because they give light, they give heat, they give warmth, and they burn away or scare off the evil spirits. And remember, in Celtic culture, October 31st was the last day of the year. November 1st was the beginning of the new year, and that is partially because of the harvest festival. So how did the people celebrate it? They wore costumes to scare away evil spirits. One of the things they did was, I'll come to it in a moment, they wore costumes to scare off evil spirits and to camouflage, it's called guising, to disguise themselves from evil spirits. That's where the tradition of costumes comes from. They told stories. What kind of stories did they tell? What else? Ghost stories. They also did a lot of other things. Remember, it's a harvest festival, and a harvest festival has a lot of things in common with fertility festivals. It's in some ways the end point of that. If you go back to spring, you've now come full cycle. It's over, and will spring come back again? And one of the traditions the Scots did in Burns's Halloween is they bobbed for apples. Now, bobbing for apples in our culture is something children do and people did as a kind of goofy thing to do. Originally, bobbing for apples had much more in common with the contemporary American custom of the bride throwing her garter and the first person to catch it of the bridesmaids will be the next one to be married. Well, bobbing for apples had a similar thing. You did it in one of two ways. A woman, sometimes a man with their hands tied behind them, would try to catch an apple swinging on a string. The first person who could do that, that apple then would be the first person or the next person to marry. Similarly, bobbing for apples in a barrel. First person to get the apple will be the next person to marry. You can't see this. It's unfortunately obscured by Ben and I. Another way of foretelling who you're going to marry or who your lover might be would be to bite into an apple while looking into a mirror. The notion being that the apparition of your future lover would appear behind you. Another thing they engaged in was spadomancy. Spadomancy is an ancient form of divination, of fortune telling, by using scattered ashes. And they thought by burning nuts, remember Burns said they burned their nuts, they would burn hazelnuts, scatter the ashes and see, they thought they would then see the letters or the name of their future beloved in the ashes. Burns also talks about Nellie, who lost her tap-based pickle while kittling with Rob in a haystack that night. Well, tap-based pickle is Celtic Scottish euphemism for a woman or a girl losing her virginity, and Kitlin is cuddling. So Nellie lost her virginity that night cuddling with Robin Haystack. And they also partied and made merry. So many of those things come from Burns. Now, where did those things come from? If that's what the Scots were doing in the 18th century, where did those originate? Well, that takes us back to another ancient festival. And we talked about this, we've talked about it a couple of times. We're going to see next month that, for example, why is Christmas celebrated on December 25th? It is because of the ancient Roman holiday of the Saturnalia, which was a festival, a feast honoring the sun god Invictus, honoring Saturn, the god of the Roman god of agriculture. And that happened to be done at the winter solstice. And because of the Julian, as opposed to the Gregorian calendar, the winter solstice occurred on the 25th, not on the 21st. And later, we will see next month, I'm not going to give the whole thing away, that was co-opted into being Christ's birthday. It was Christianized. Behind Ben and I's little thumbnails here, or mine, if I think I'm only the one seeing Ben at the moment, but is the Roman festival of Lupercalia, which we talked about in actually the very first episode of this, is the roots of Valentine. It happened, the Roman fertility ritual of Lupercalia occurred on February 14th in the 6th century. Pope Julius decided that he needed to suppress a resurgence of the Lupercalian festival. He declared St. Valentine's Day. Eventually, Valentine's Day has morphed into our Lover's Day. I'm not going to get into wassailing. Similarly, down here in the left-hand corner, Easter. Why is the celebration of Christ's resurrection called Easter, a word that doesn't occur in scripture? It's because Ostara was a Nordic festival celebrating the vernal equinox, and the star of that was Eostre, E-O-S-T-R-E, the goddess of the west wind, and her symbols were chicken, were eggs, chicks, and those wonderful propagators, rabbits. That becomes Easter. So what happened is, of course, is it's called the Christianization of pagan holidays. The church co-opted these holidays as they converted the pagan north and northwest of Europe. I'm, in the interest of time, going to skip over the wedding ceremony, but these ancient customs. I will talk about one, not the bridal veil because of secrecy. Bridesmaids once were actually guardians who had a bodyguard function, but Why do people wear their wedding ring on their left hand on their fourth finger, if I count the thumb as a finger? It's because the ancient Greeks thought there was a vein, the venus amoris, that ran from that finger along your arm to your heart. And therefore, they wore the ring on that finger, which is why you do it today. But back to Halloween. Well, Halloween's origins in Celtic countries, which is what we are the inheritors of, is the ancient Celtic festival, harvest festival of Samhain. It is spelled S-A-M-H-A-I-N, but it's pronounced Samhain, S-O-W or S-A-W hyphen W-I-N, Samhain or Samhain. And that's the festival that Burns is talking about. And how did the ancient Celts celebrate that? Well, it marked the end of the year. It marked the end of the harvest. It was the day upon which they remembered the departed souls. It was the end of one cycle, the beginning of the next. Remember, October 31st went into November 1st. And for the Celts, day ended at dusk and the next day began. A day ran from dusk to dusk. So October 31st was actually at the end of the year and the beginning of the next year. And the Celts celebrated it by bonfires. They celebrated it by feasting. They celebrated it by going from door to door in the villages, searching for soul cakes, as they thought the souls of the departed returned to their homes, and they would give out soul cakes. That's where trick-or-treating came from. And so when then the ancient Celtic custom, ancient Celtic harvest festival of Samhain, gives rise to Halloween, as we just talked about, but that is specifically done in the, so when is celebrated by lighting bonfires, etc., as I've said, and it marks the end of the harvest season and the beginning of the dark season. Do you have enough food to get through the winter? In Celtic culture, winter was looked upon as the dying season because people didn't make it through the winter. Well, that then gets co-opted by the Roman Catholic Church, when in 609, Pope Boniface creates the Roman Pantheon, honoring all martyrs, and began the Catholic Feast of All Martyrs Day. 300 years later, actually 200 and some years later, in the 9th century, Pope Gregory III moved the festival's date to November 1st. Now, why would Pope Boniface have, Pope Gregory, excuse me, have moved the festival's date to November 1st. Think St. Patrick converting the pagan Irish. Can think of the beginning of the conversion of the pagan Celts, the pagan Anglo-Saxons, etc. And what Pope Gregory was attempting to do was to co-opt the holiday of Samhain by turning it into Allhallows Eve, the night before All Saints Day, All Hallows Day. And he also created All Souls Day. All Souls Day is November 2nd, All Saints Day is November 1st, All Hallows Eve is October 31st. And so what you have is a direct, you have a direct adoption of pagan dates and a pagan holiday by converting it to a Christian holiday to facilitate the conversion of the northern and northwestern Europe. And that's where it comes from. So Halloween, and I think most people know that Halloween is All Hallows Eve. I'm not sure most people understand that All Saints Day, November 1st, in the Roman Catholic tradition, it's a holy day of obligation. All Saints Day does exactly what it says. It honors all of the church, all of the saints of the church. All Souls Day honors all of the Christian departed. Well, anyway, okay, that's the history of Halloween. How did it get to America? Why did you have a pumpkin on your front stoop this fall? Why, if you have a grandchild or a child, were they out dressed up as Spider-Man with a bag getting candy? How did Halloween come to America? Well, Halloween comes to America initially, of course, with the Pilgrims in the early 17th century. But the Pilgrims, the Puritans, did not celebrate Halloween. They looked upon it as pagan, quite frankly. Actually, they looked upon it as a combination of pagan and popish. One, they had some kind of root understanding. Remember, most of the Puritans weren't themselves English, so they understood Celtic culture and rejected Celtic culture. And two, they looked upon Halloween as a Catholic holiday, a popish holiday, and they rejected that. So they didn't celebrate Halloween, although they did hang witches or women accused of being witches. But Halloween comes to America in the South. In Catholic Maryland, it was celebrated, and it was celebrated much as it was celebrated in Robert Burns's poem. It was all the bobbing for apples, there was partying, people. In colonial Virginia, and so in Catholic Maryland and in the Anglican colonies, Virginia and the Carolinas, it was celebrated. That costume there is, obviously, there was no photography in the 17th and 18th century. That's a recreation of how they would have dressed in costume, as is that picture. Well, Halloween comes to America, but it doesn't begin to blossom in America until the middle of the 19th century, when, under the influence of a mass immigration, and there was a mass immigration in the 1830s, 40s, and 50s of Irish Catholics, Celts, who brought their Celtic traditions with them, and also German Catholics, particularly after 1848, and they brought their traditions with them. And in the late 19th century, Halloween got to be quite raucous in the United States and was characterized by pranks, the tricks in trick-or-treat, such as putting some farmer's cow on his barn, a trick not easily explained, but they did it, apparently. They also began to grow pumpkins. Pumpkins are an American plant. You would not find them in Europe prior. Later, the seeds were taken back, but originally it's an American plant. They tipped over outhouses and they tore up cabbage patches. They also had the beginning of the haunted house movement. Now, why were houses considered to be haunted? Well, most people in the 19th century, actually most people prior to, I would guess, the middle of the 20th century, this is an interesting question on funerary customs, but most people died at home. And there was a suspicion in a culture that believed in souls and spirits, that perhaps that person's spirit didn't completely abandon the home, that it still lurked. And so that's where the notion of haunted houses came from. It gets bigger, however, in American Halloween tradition, because during the Depression, young males, taking perhaps the trick and trick-or-treating too much to heart, caused a lot of vandalism. And so one of the things that was done to tame them was the creation of the haunted house movement and having young men be part of that. And then eventually, as many things, it gets domesticated and tamed. Those are watching this program of more or less my vintage, that picture will look reasonably familiar. And then of course, today, Halloween is even an adult holiday in which adults dress up and party. So that's how Halloween, that's Halloween's roots. That's how Halloween comes to America. Do witches really ride brooms? That's an interesting question that one is a little bit beyond us. But remember, what do witches have to do? The whole question of witches would be an interesting program. I'm not so sure series, but would be an interesting program unto itself. But what do witches have to do? Well, witches were thought to be, remember, October 31st, the last night of the year in Celtic culture was thought to be the night of witches. And of course, witches in a culture in which medicine was really natural healing, and that was primarily the province of women. It was primarily the province of single women who were in a really socially ambiguous and vulnerable position in any given culture. And out of that, because they understood what roots and berries natural medicine, they were thought to have kind of magical powers. And it's an easy transition from thinking someone has magical powers to think that perhaps those powers are not entirely benign. And that's where the legend of witches come. The broom was a great emblem of female domesticity. It was always near the fireplace or the hearth, which is where you get witches going up the chimney. In any event, we don't have time in this overview to talk about witches, but that's what witches were about. What about trick-or-treating and candy corn? Well, trick-or-treating, if you'll recall, I said the ancient Celts thought that the spirits came back and would go back to their own home or to their neighbor's homes looking for food or sustenance. They would bake what were called soul cakes. Eventually, other people got dressed up, as I said, in costumes and would go door to door looking for food or handouts and soul cakes. That, by the time you get to the Middle Ages, gives rise to mumming and the mummers, which we're going to hear in next month, has a direct correlation to Christmas caroling. The mummers would go door to door, sing and expect a handout. And that became really entrenched as part of the Halloween tradition. Going door to door. The tricking came in if you were stingy enough or so stingy you wouldn't give anyone anything. Well, by the time you get to 20th century America, that's domesticated, particularly in the 1952 Disney film Trick or Treat with Donald Duck and his nephews Huey, Dewey, and Louie. And you have candy corn. Candy corn is the ubiquitous Halloween candy. It was created in the late 19th century by the Wunderlei Candy Company, one of their employees, Richard, I believe, Reininger, invented candy corn. Nowadays, there's over 7 billion pieces of candy corn sold a year. And of course, trick-or-treating has become a children's activity of going door to door, has been totally domesticated and going door to door for candy. Where does the jack-o'-lantern come from? The jack-o'-lantern, why is a carved pumpkin called a jack-o'-lantern? Well, that's because in the west of Ireland, there is the legend of Stingy Jack, who would not give anything to anyone else. And because he was stingy and would not help people, was cast out and had to walk alone. And Jack would carve a squash, a pumpkin, and put a candle in it to light his way at night. And so the squash with the candle in it, the pumpkin in our culture, became known as a jack-o'-lantern because it was the lantern that Stingy Jack used to find his way from door to door where he was frequently rebuffed. But that's why jack-o'-lanterns are called jack-o'-lanterns. Actually, the name is literal. It's not metaphoric. It was Jack's lantern. What's the most famous Halloween song of all time? Believe it or not, there are such lists. Top 50 Halloween songs of all time. Recently, Alexandra Petrie in the Washington Post had one. Rosemary Clooney's The Wobblin' Goblin came in at number 50. some of her selections were a stretch. I don't think The Doors, People Are Strange was meant to be a Halloween song. But the number one Halloween song of all time on just about any list that you see, compiled by sales, however you want to do it, Rolling Stone, Spotify, Billboard, everybody is.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an eerie sight, for my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
That was Bobby Boris Pickett and the Crypt Kickers with their 1962 number one hit, million selling, The Monster Mash. It continues to be the number one Halloween song of all time. They also, I think, had number 14 on that Washington Post list of Alexandra Petrie's, The Transylvania Twist. So that's Halloween. Halloween is a religious holiday, and like many of our holidays, we've lost its religious, or many people have lost its religious significance, and it's become a purely secular holiday, and it's rapidly growing in popularity. You now see people decorating homes. That actually is just in the last 5, maybe 10 years where that's really taken off, where people decorate their homes much like they do at Christmas time, interestingly enough. Sales continue to go up. Part of what is driving Halloween sales is it's actually becoming an adult holiday for partying, which would be exactly what Burns' merry country folk were doing 250 years ago. They were partying. What else? Well, let's switch gears.
I've got plenty to be thankful for.
There aren't a lot of Thanksgiving songs. That's probably the most famous. Thanksgiving Day in Erie, Pennsylvania. Well, some of us, I didn't live in Erie in 1956. I always joke I've lived in Erie for over 50 years, and my obituary would say I'm from somewhere else. But many Erieites will remember this blizzard of the Thanksgiving Day blizzard of 1956 that paralyzed the city. And again, another Eugene Ivern Saturday Evening Post thing. And Erieites celebrated in a number of ways, obviously feasting. One of the Erie traditions, not unique to Erie, but it is done widely in Erie, is restaurants and social service agencies opening up and feeding the homeless and the poor. This is Mercyhurst Prep doing a free Thanksgiving dinner. Thanksgiving greetings from Erie, Pennsylvania. Not quite sure what that's supposed to look like. That certainly isn't the peninsula. Some, though, speaking of the peninsula, I believe they still do this. I've actually run in it years ago when I still could run. Thanksgiving Day turkey trot. The Erie Otters actually play a game, or did pre-pandemic, on Thanksgiving Day. And of course, everyone has a Thanksgiving feast. And that, of course, is a Norman Rockwell. Where was the first Thanksgiving? Well, interestingly enough, as we discovered in our time, anything can be controversial. There are three contenders for the first Thanksgiving. One, as some pedants have pointed out, there is evidence in some journals that in 1592, a Spanish priest held, an explorer held a Thanksgiving feast in St. Augustine, Florida, for his crew's safe arrival. Virginia claims in 1619, has nothing to do with the 1619 project, but on December 4th, 1619, in Virginia, similarly, because of the safe arrival of a ship, the Margaret, there was a Thanksgiving celebration in colonial Jamestown. But the Thanksgiving that has triumphed, or the one anyways that custom says is the first Thanksgiving, occurred, as we will learn in a moment, in Puritan New England, and that was a direct result of the Protestant Reformation. That's Henry VIII, who began the Protestant Reformation in England, or in English-speaking countries. And part of the Protestant Reformation was the purifying, hence Puritans, of Catholic traditions. And two of the things that they created were the notion of days of fasting and humiliation and days of thanksgiving. Days of fasting and humiliation are exactly what it says, days that were to be set aside in fasting and prayer, meditating upon the travails of the time. Days of Thanksgiving were not to be feasting. They were to be days set aside in prayer, giving thanks for one's salvation. the Puritans that brought that, the Pilgrims in 1621, and then of course the great Puritan migration in 1630 brought all of that to North America. And the first Thanksgiving occurred at Plymouth Plantation in October 1621. It didn't necessarily occur in November. It occurred sometime between early October to middle late November 1621. Almost everything that is known about that first Thanksgiving is in a letter written by Edward Winslow. Edward Winslow was one of the original arrivals on the Mayflower, and he was one of the 50 or so people who had managed to survive the first year. Over half, more than 50, there were about 100 people on the Mayflower, and more than half of them died that first year because of the severe conditions of trying to survive in the wilderness. They celebrated that at Plymouth Plantation. This is a recreation. This is there actually in Plymouth, Massachusetts. I've been there. It's really worth the trip if you're ever there. It's obviously neither as large nor as elegant as Colonial Williamsburg, but it is a recreation of what the original Plymouth Plantation looked like based on the best archaeological evidence. The first Thanksgiving was actually not a Thanksgiving of humiliation and prayer, but it was a harvest festival rejoicing in the success of their first major harvest. Whether or not they invited the Native Americans is somewhat disputed. Winslow's letter gives an ambiguous account. There are actually accounts of it in certain journals. I wouldn't call them journals, but in certain documents with the Wampanoags, the Native American tribe that was there, the Puritans who had survived, the Pilgrims, excuse me, who had survived, had begun feasting, yet they were also doing military maneuvers, shooting off guns. The Wampanoag came because they had created a treaty or a pact of mutual defense with the Pilgrims. They thought perhaps they were under attack. And when they showed up, there was a tense couple of minutes before the Native American warriors, about 90 of them, they outnumbered the Pilgrims almost 2-1. And the Pilgrims realized there was no hostility, and then the Native Americans joined in and they celebrated with feasting. Obviously, this is centuries after the fact painting, recreating that of a Pilgrim woman feeding, I'm going to butcher the pronunciation, so I'm not going to say it. That's Massasoit, but Massasoit is not a first name. Massasoit means chief or sachem in Wampanoag, and that would be the chief there, the sachem, the head of the Wampanoags. And of course, the notion of giving thanks was there. But what did they eat at the first Thanksgiving? What was the menu? Well, they may or may not have had turkey, but wild turkey would have been stringy and dry. And remember, they're on a seashore. They had lobster, clams. If they had any fowl at all, it would have been grouse, pigeons, and pheasant. They had vegetables, root vegetables, and they did not have pumpkin pie because A, they had no flour, B, they had no butter, and C, they didn't have an oven. The classic American feast is a 19th century creation. And I don't really have the time to get into it, but when I've done this presentation once before and for another group, yes, there really was a Squanto. And Squanto's story is worth telling, and you can hear the longer version of it when I do on the QLN version of this. But Squanto did exist. He did help the Pilgrims. He taught them how to farm, and he was actually the liaison between them and the indigenous people. So there was a first Thanksgiving, and the first Thanksgiving, as custom has decreed, was the one in Plymouth, Massachusetts. But why do we celebrate Thanksgiving today? Well, we celebrate Thanksgiving today largely because of two 19th century women. The holiday was regional. It was in New England. While Southerners had versions of it, it was not celebrated nearly as often or in the same way as it was done in New England. Westerners had kinds of celebrations, but they weren't the same thing. The Thanksgiving that you and I know, the typical American prototypical celebration, is a New England creation. And it was a creation in some way, not a creation of, but it became a holiday, but through the efforts of Sara Josepha Hale. And it was specifically aimed at two things. One, celebrating union, the Northern Union and celebrating national identity, and also trying to draw back people into some sense of comity and commonness through the early 19th century. She, for 36 years, attempted to have Thanksgiving become a major holiday. I think I may actually, in the springtime, Ben, do a program on her. She is somebody most people need to know more about. I jokingly said she was the Martha Stewart of the 19th century, but with all due respect to Martha Stewart, she was much more than Martha Stewart. She was not only the arbiter of taste, middle-class taste, she was also a creator of culture. She wrote a novel. When her husband died at the age of 24, she made two vows. One, she would wear black for the rest of her life as a symbol of mourning, and two, a gutsy lady, she decided to become a professional writer in order to support herself. She wrote a novel, Life North and South, one of the first novels ever to address the issue of slavery. On the strength of that novel, she got a job as the editor of the Ladies Magazine, which then got her the job of as the editor of Godey's Ladies Book, which was the definitive. Think Martha Stewart's Living, Better Homes and Garden, Town and Country, all of them wrapped into one. And she was the editor of that. And she also wrote The Good Housekeeper, how to maintain a home. She was the definitive defender of home and hearth and definer of home and hearth in the 19th century. She was also a poet. In fact, she wrote a very famous poem that everybody listening to this at least knows the first stanza, of which everybody listening knows the first stanza. Mary had a little lamb, its fleece was white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. Sara Josepha Hale, though, created our Thanksgiving by that 36-year campaign. Now, the very first Thanksgiving through presidential proclamation was George Washington in the 19th century, but Hale finally succeeded when in 1863, she wrote a letter to Abraham Lincoln, the year of Gettysburg, saying we need to make Thanksgiving a day of Union solidarity, by which she meant the Northern Union solidarity, which later drew back in all of the people of the United States. Lincoln proclaimed then on October 3rd, 1863, he set the last Thursday of November would be the day of Thanksgiving, because the day bounced around. It was celebrated on different days in different parts of the country. Lincoln made it the end of November and made it a national holiday. And that was because of Sara Josepha Hale's campaign. The other woman who was instrumental in this is Lydia Maria Child, who also became a novelist. She wrote the first book about interracial marriage in American culture, Hobomok. She also was the author of The American Frugal Housewife, which was a cookbook. It was the cookbook of the 19th century. But she was also much more than just a cookbook writer. She was an abolitionist. She wrote a book entitled An Appeal in Favor of That Class of Americans Called Africans. She was one of the founders of the American Anti-Slavery Society. She was the editor of their newspaper, the National Anti-Slavery Standard. She wrote the appeal to the legislators of Massachusetts that it is the duty of disobedience to disobey the Fugitive Slave Act. She wrote the Freedman's Book. She also was a feminist. She was an ally and a colleague of Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and in many ways, their intellectual fountain. She wrote The History of the Condition of Women in Various Ages and Nations. That actually, therefore, undercut the sales of that cookbook that I just mentioned. She was a radical feminist for her time. Now, what has any of that got to do with Thanksgiving? She also wrote the New England Boys Song, which is sometimes called by its first line, Across the River and Through the Wood, and some nowadays is simply known as the Thanksgiving poem. Over the river and through the wood, the grandfather's house we go. The horse knows the way to carry the sleigh through the white and drifted snow. That's Lydia Maria Child. How you celebrate Thanksgiving, you owe to those two 19th century women. Thanksgiving in the 19th century, the black and white photos aren't that obvious, but it's a time of feasting, it's a time of families, it's a time of reunion. One of the interesting things is, if we wanted to talk about climate change, is in all the images of Thanksgiving in the 19th century, it's winter. And I just thought that was kind of interesting incidental evidence. It was also a major holiday amongst Union troops in the North. The images of that, of course, as you're going home, turkeys, parties, shopping for food. An interesting tradition, Irish immigrants in the 19th century, their children, confusing the holidays, dressed up in rags and went door to door on Thanksgiving trick-or-treating. They were called ragamuffins because of the way they dressed. That's where the word comes from, ragamuffins, a muffin being a young child. It was ultimately banned. But of course, most people associate Thanksgiving with a feast. Why does the date move around? Ben talked about that earlier. In 1937, I think it was, Franklin D. Roosevelt, trying to get an extra week of shopping, tried to move Thanksgiving back to the third week. There was an uproar. Retailers kind of were for it, but football schedule makers didn't. And it generally created a headache because in different parts of the country, we had kind of gone back to where we were in the early 19th century. It occurred on different dates. In some parts of the country, it was the third week, other parts the fourth. Finally, in 1941, Congress passed a law declaring it to be the last Thursday in November, end of discussion. But if you ever wondered why it bounced around, and those of us of a certain age can actually still remember when it kind of bounced around, that's why. So Thanksgiving Day in mid-20th century America. I know the general vintage of most Jeffersonians, so I'm showing the images that mid-20th century, we got Lucy. You have the woeful Detroit Lions playing the football game on Sunday. It used to be they always played the Green Bay Packers. Now I think they play different people. But it is still to this day, the first of the three football games on Thanksgiving will be a Detroit Lions game because that was the first one. Miracle on 34th Street, families together. This photograph, by the way, I found on the web, which is a good piece of advice, is be very careful with your family photos. Don't just throw them out because there's no telling where they'll show up. I have no idea who these people are. It's also Native Americans on November 26, 1970 declared it the National Day of Mourning, and that is now held across the country as a Native American Indigenous Peoples celebration, but it is held at Coles Hill in Plymouth, Massachusetts. But we've got Thanksgiving dinners, as we all know that. And of course, Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade underscored the commercialism of it. And then that then leads into Black Friday and Cyber Monday. So that's Thanksgiving in a nutshell. There's our Detroit Lions. And actually, that's the history of Halloween and Thanksgiving. And the one thing I would want to say in concluding is a little better on time today. One thing I would want to say on concluding is, how does this tie into the American tapestry? And I'll talk about this more next month on Christmas. Thanksgiving, more than Halloween. Halloween is kind of an interesting holiday. Americans celebrate. I thought it'd be interesting to look at its roots. It is one thing all Americans, regardless of political persuasion, celebrate Halloween in various and sundry ways. And it's become basically, its harvest roots, harvest festival roots have been more or less forgotten. Some people do understand All Hallows Eve and All Saints Day and All Souls Day, but it's basically become a day of pranks, partying with children, it's trick-or-treating, and having fun. And with adults, it's trick-or-treating and having fun, just like Robert Burns's Merry Country Folk. Thanksgiving ties a little more directly into the tapestry and the theme we're talking about, because Sara Josepha Hale, but others, and others in the middle and late 19th century used it, and as we'll hear next month, Christmas, to try to create them to be national holidays. Because there really were no national holidays. The only national holiday was the 4th of July. Everything else was kind of regional and had its adherents. They wanted to create national holidays so that people could set aside their differences for a moment and bond together over some common thing. And Thanksgiving and Christmas were those two things. And we'll hear next month, Sara Josepha Hale had a role, had a role in Christmas becoming a national holiday. So that's the harvest festivals in America, Ben.
Dr. Roth, I got to thank you. And that was a lot of fun. And I'll start with a more serious question to say, you know, I want to get your take on how much these overlap in the profound and the banal, because I think we see both of these present. But before I get there, do you see it? Because I know some people say we cannot put the Christmas decorations up until Thanksgiving gets out of the way. Yet on screen, we see Christmas morning, Santa comes to town. We watch him come to town in the Macy's Day Parade. So are you a wait until Thanksgiving's over to have Christmas, or are you embrace both and have them at the same time kind of celebrator?
I tend to be from the school of thought, but maybe that's just because I'm old. I tend to be from the school of thought you shouldn't put up Christmas decorations until the day after Thanksgiving. But I think that ship has sailed. And it's the same thing with Halloween. In fact, one of the things I was noticing, some retailers now call it Spooky September as they're trying to push the holiday back into September. And I think on the radio program, they made the wisecrack. Pretty soon we're going to have Christmas in July and Halloween in May. But it does blend both the profound, maybe not so much the political, but, you know, the religious nature of the country, its heritage, but also the banal. It's a holiday. It's a party. I mean, holiday, the root of it is holy day, but it turns also into a secular party. And by the way, that's ancient. As next month, when we talk about Christmas, and we know there's a lot of people today who think controversially that Christmas has been profaned. But in point of fact, the sacred and the profane and how Christmas is celebrated actually goes all the way back. It's ancient. So that to me is no longer as much of an issue. But I think what's interesting, particularly about Thanksgiving and perhaps in this short amount of time, one of the things I realized, particularly as I've been working on the Christmas program, is that actually you could do a series about, maybe not six or seven, but you could do a 2 or 3 part series on each of these holidays if you really, you know, to give them. I mean, I skirted over, for example, Samhain and what that means. And I really skirted over what the Puritans' a day of Thanksgiving was supposed to be. But the thing that's interesting is both North and South, it bound the people together. And that's what Hale was about. She was trying to find something that would pull people together that transcended politics, you know. And if we think we've got a divided culture, they had a civil war, 675. I know we have people watching this that know more about the civil war than I do, and I just had a mental click. So it was 625,000 or 675,000. Let's just say 650,000 plus or minus 25,000 Americans died in the civil war. And since the population is roughly now 3.5 times as great, you would have a number flirting with 2 million Americans getting killed in an intramural war to approach that kind of suffering. And Hale was trying to figure out how to pull this back together. That's partially what she, I don't want to give her over credit, but I think she's been obscured. And Department of Great Minds Think Alike, I just noticed doing some research, actually literally this morning, a biography of Hale, the first full-scale biography of Hale is just been published, and I just bought it this morning. I'm going to read it. She's deserves more attention than she's gotten.
Yeah, and I think in that, you know, I would ask, where did we lose the history? Because I and maybe I'm off base here, maybe it's just me, but I learned a lot today about both of those holidays, and I can say I've participated in celebrations of those holidays every year of my life. And I didn't know a lot of that. Have we always sort of just lost the history and we gravitate toward the banal and just the celebration? Well, or at one point, did Americans know the history of these holidays better than we might know it today?
I don't think at any point that people know it better than we know it today. I mean, there would always have been some people who knew it, but they'd have been a very small number. And I don't think Americans need to be belabored on that. It's most people. Now, obviously, I love history, etc. I mean, it comes pretty obvious. I've always made the comment, people walk through history every day and have no idea why they do what they do. You know, it's what's the famous line? Some wise guy said, who discovered water? Yeah, you can be pretty certain it wasn't a fish. Yeah. I mean, so people, these holidays are just there. And I think you have to be careful. I know our other colleague, or he's becoming a colleague of ours, Phil Payne, and you and I have talked about this. You have to be careful that the academic study of history can be socially corrosive, you know? So when I point out, there's some little minor debate about what was the first Thanksgiving, and then there's actually a very much larger debate about what actually occurred at Plymouth, because the aftermath of that, not the immediate aftermath in 1621, but within 50 years, those Native American, those indigenous people and those pilgrims celebrating together were at war. And what some people would say is the bloodiest war Americans ever fought. When you figure out proportionately, I mean, the casualties as a proportion of the population, that's King Philip's War in 1675. So I think you have to balance knowing that history with the culture binding or bonding ability. And I think that's a tension between, I mean, we're dealing with it now. I don't want to get there. You know, we don't have the time. But we're dealing with that now somehow as we look upon some issues currently bubbling in our culture about our history, you know, and we need to balance the need for cohesion with the need for truth. And that gets tricky. Now with the holidays, I think the takeaway is, I'm not so sure anyone actually really ever really knew the history of all of this. They knew bits and pieces. And it's only recently that people have begun to tie it all together. We're going to talk a little bit on the Christmas thing, that there is a kind of popular idea of how Christmas occurred in America. But academic scholars, particularly a woman by the name of Penny Raystadt, has begun to point out that Christmas was actually more common than people think, but it wasn't celebrated anything like we celebrate it now. It was in bits and pieces, because Christmas as we celebrate it now, much like Thanksgiving as we celebrate it now, was not created in 1621. It was created almost intentionally in the 19th century as a way of binding a culture together. And that's fascinating to me. And I'm not so sure you can say that about any other holiday, actually.
Yeah, I think maybe the other holidays, you know, knock at the door of it, and but don't fully go through or cross that threshold. And I think, you know, so two observations from me on that. One, I appreciate knowing that, you know, we're no worse off today than perhaps we had been decades past, if not centuries past, and knowing our own history, because I think we have a tendency to romanticize this nostalgia of, well, we used to know, and we somehow lost it. Well, we've never really gotten there. Now is a moment to actually work to get us there, to understand these holidays. And then I think, too, again, the power of the banal, the power of the popular, to get us to a point of understanding the deeper. Because I think the one thing these all have in common is some sort of group activity that does bind us and brings us together, that perhaps for just one day, but maybe 256 of them, if we all have the holidays, they bring us together to set aside differences and to think about the deeper issues. And I think that as much as perhaps Christmas might be that ultimate holiday that gets us there, maybe Thanksgiving is the ultimate holiday that gets us there, all of the other holidays in some way or another attempt to come close to it, that maybe they're not quite the arc, but they're almost there.
Yeah. Every holiday we celebrate is an attempt to remember something and an attempt to bring people together. And I've got to think about that a little more and maybe develop that theme, because every holiday in some way memorializes something. Maybe memorializes is not quite the right word, and in the process of doing that tries to bring people together to create a common culture.
And I think this goes back at one of the things we talked about before in a past episode, where he said, well, you know, does the continue addition of holidays then in some way lessen what we have been celebrating before? And I have to say with emphasis, no. And I think that's the American story, right? That the more we add into our story, the more diverse it becomes, the more inclusive we are, the better we all are, because this is back to the banal, a way for us to understand the things we perhaps don't understand. And what easier a way to understand than to say, let's celebrate together. You know, what do you do? Oh, we celebrate. Exactly. And now that we've, you know, broken bread and opened a bottle of wine or shared candy corn or whatever it is, we have in some way diffused this tension of, well, I don't understand this and it's foreign to me. Now we can join in and have a communion together and learn something deeper.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's right. I'm looking at the clock here. We're probably testing our viewers' patience.
I was going to say that, and I was going to say we have so much more to talk about, and we did. We knocked on the door. We didn't go through about Christmas. We have that one coming up, and we do have a recording of a program prior where we discussed "Twas the Night Before Christmas," and I'd encourage folks to head over to the JES website to check that out. But Dr. Andrew Roth, scholar in residence at the JES and host of the American Tapestry Project on WQLN Public Media, with episodes available on the NPR One app. Thank you for this lesson in Halloween and Thanksgiving. For me, this has been a lot of fun and a lot of education. So thanks for sharing your insights and knowledge with us.
You're welcome. Always, it's fun to do it.
And of course, to all of you watching along at home, thank you for tuning in. These programs and discussions and the exchange of information and ideas and celebrations would not be possible without you, whether you're watching live on the JES Facebook page or tuning in later to stream these programs on demand. Of course, for more information about upcoming JES digital programming, do visit our website, jeserie.org. There you are going to find videos of other past presentations available to stream on demand, other publications, including reports, essays, and timely writings, as well as Dr. Roth's book notes series, as well as information about upcoming discussions. And of course, be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. For the Jefferson Educational Society, I'm Ben Spagg, and may your holidays be as merry and bright and as formative as they can be. Thanks for listening and learning with us.